Great. So hi everyone, I'm Vasanta. I and Tyasha have a lot in common. So even I have pursued my chemical engineering from IIT Kharagpur, but in a dual degree course. I had my past internships at Procter & Gamble as well. And before that, I interned at University of Tokyo in Japan. And I will be joining McKinsey & Company as well as a business analyst this year. And yeah, I really look forward to interacting with all of you.
Okay, so without further ado, let's start with the discussion. So what was the inspiration behind pursuing an MBA? Yasha, would you like to start?
Sure. So I think for me, the major reason why I wanted to pursue an MBA was because I knew that in the future, I would like a management degree because I wanted to go into the corporate world. However, I also knew that I wanted a few years of work experience before I could actually think about an MBA. Since then, I would be able to absorb the absorb whatever was being taught or essentially have it implemented. And I think because of that, that was the major reason why I wanted to apply for a deferred MBA. Because deferred MBA not only helped me guarantee an MBA in the future so that I could take risks right now, but also I could garner a few years of work experience and learn how the corporate world works before having this sort of an MBA. And that's the primary motivation why I applied for it.
Okay, Vasanta.
Yeah, so I actually did not think a lot because applying for a deferred MBA is a low risk, high reward opportunity. So after placements, you have like 4 or 5 months of doing nothing at all. And the last semester of campus is anyways very, very free, not a lot of subjects and everything. So I was just looking for ways to use my time and I came across this opportunity and I applied. So a deferred MBA is great in that sense because you're not giving commitment to the institute right away, but they reserve a seat for you whenever you want to join, maybe a two or three years later on. So I thought I could take that call later when I had the chance. So I just applied and it worked out.
So one common doubt we have that after graduating from such a reputed engineering college, why did you choose for an MBA?
Because the degree is different, right? So whatever we are doing, for example, me or Tyasha in McKinsey & Company has nothing to do with what we have learned in an academic perspective from IIT Kharagpur or any other IIT per se. So if you want to enter the management world or the consulting world and you want to progress, a lot of times it does help to have an MBA degree where you have traditionally studied what management is in a proper curriculum rather than, you know, learning it from your positions of responsibility or your past internships. That is one thing I would say.
I think for me, another reason was, and this was a doubt that did come into my mind. So I always wanted to do an MBA, but I was not sure whether I should apply for IIMs within India or I should apply for abroad colleges. And I think that is something, like Vasanta said, that this final application of like applying to colleges abroad came during like our last semester when we had IIM. But for me, this question came and I thought a lot about where I wanted to do. And I think the idea that, you know, I wanted to do management was something clear. But I think the idea of how I want to progress in the corporate world, a management degree would help me progress in the corporate world or even like venture into other areas. For example, if I ever wanted to PVC or if I ever want to start my own startup. And I think there the IIT degree in specific would not help me as much as like a management degree would in terms of like knowing how to do all of that. And that is one particular reason I chose that. However, again, I agree that since for IIMs especially, I thought that maybe the kind of companies which I would get into would be very similar to what I am getting right now, right? So for example, if I want to go into consulting, McKinsey & Company would recruit from IIMs as well as here. So at that point, I thought that there was a trade-off in which I would have to think about, and that is the major reason why I tried applying abroad.
Okay, so that was quite an informed choice. Okay, let's move on with the next question.
So the next question is about the pattern that is followed in exams. What is the structure and all for GRE and GMAT both?
I think Vasanta, you can start and I'll go there after.
Sure. So I gave my GMAT. I actually never considered GRE because I don't know, it just never came to my mind because I hadn't kept MS as an option at all. I was only looking for an MBA. And GMAT is specially designed for MBA applicants. So that is why I went ahead and gave my GMAT. So the pattern, so one thing that differentiates GMAT to most of the competitive exams that we have given so far, be it the JEE or be it any other, even your GATE or whatever you have attempted, is that it's an adaptive test. So what happens is your next question would depend on how well you answered all of your previous questions. So if you're doing well, then your questions keep getting difficult and your entire question set would be very difficult if you're especially aiming for a score between 700 to 800. So your score at the end of the day does not just depend upon how correctly you answered your questions, but it also depends on the difficulty level of your set as a whole. So basically, it's a very complex way of scoring and nobody understands it accurately today. So at the end of the exam, you just get a score that pops on your screen, but you can't say that, you know, I answered three wrong, which is why my score is 10 points less than somebody else. You can't say that. So that is what makes it quite challenging because you can't go back to the previous question once you have attempted it because it's adaptive and you just keep answering. You can't go to the next question without attempting the current question. And it's very difficult to manage your time because of that, especially because you can't, segregate your time based on the difficulty of questions. You can't say that, oh, this is difficult. Let me move on to the next one and come back to this. So that is what makes GMAT very different from everything else. In terms of the pattern itself, right? So there are four sections in GMAT. The first, so you can get to choose which order you want to attempt those sections in. So there's a quantitative section, which has about 35 questions. And there's another verbal section, which again is for 65 minutes. Again, the same number of questions. Then there is something called an integrated reasoning, which is a lot like data interpretation. So there are charts and graphs on the screen and you need to interpret that into, you know, tangible numbers. And lastly, it's something called analytical writing assessment, which is essentially like an essay writing for another 30 minutes. So there are four sections. Quantitative tests your math, quick math and everything. And it's mostly at the level of 11th and 12th grade mathematics. It's not very complicated, especially for IIT students. So quant is not usually something that concerns anybody who has done JEE before. The most difficult section that anybody from India who attempts GMAT in general finds is verbal, which is, again, grammar, sentence correction, critical reasoning, reading comprehension, and all of these things which you know, we might have lost touch with because we haven't done that since our 10th grade. So yeah, in general, that is how GMAT is. So for quantitative and verbal together, you get a score out of 800. So that is the score that we say, right? So I had 750, which is only for quant and verbal. The other two, integrated reasoning and analytical writing assessment, the other two sections, the score is given separately. And they're not as important as quant and verbal. So the score out of 800 that you get for quant and verbal is the most important aspect of your GMAT score. I hope that covers most of it. So I think, Tiasha, you can take up for GRE.
Yeah, sure. So I think firstly, I'll start with, like Sambha said, the GMAT is the preferred exam for MBA. And it was a hard decision for me to decide between whether I wanted to get GRE or GMAT. What essentially clinched it for me that I'd rather get GRE than GMAT was two things. The first is the amount of time I had available. So essentially, during January, February, when I started preparation, I procrastinated a lot, which meant that I only effectively had 1 month before I before I could give the exams. And then I looked through the patterns of both the exams and I realized that GRE pattern, which was more vocabulary heavy rather than grammar heavy, as opposed to like GMAT being more grammar heavy, the vocab heavy part was easier for me to prepare and I felt that I would do better in that. And I researched a lot, I talked to people about whether or not it was worth it because MBA, most colleges prefer GMAT over GRE, that's something very common. And I thought about whether it would be worth it or not, but then I finally ended up deciding that maybe I should just give GRE and let whatever be, like, because I thought that in 1 month I wouldn't be able to cover it. But furthermore, I thought that if I ever wanted to do a master's in the future, I wanted to keep that option open, and that's why I gave the GRE. So now starting with the structure of the exam, the structure of GRE, the syllabus is very common to what GMAT, like Vasanta said, but the structure is a little bit different. So there are two writing sections in the beginning, a 30 minute for analyzing an issue and then 30 minutes for analyzing an argument. And these two writing sections come right in the beginning. After that, there are four sections, and these are also section adaptive. So there are two vocabulary and two mathematics and one experimental section, which can be either the quant or essentially verbal. But they don't really tell you which one is experimental. Experimental as in it's not scored and it doesn't count in your final score. But you don't know which one it is, so you have to attempt all equally. And based on how well you do your first quant and first verbal, your second quant and second verbal become harder. So if you do your first verbal very well, your second verbal will become extremely difficult. And similarly for quant, right? And that is something, that is the way it works. Apart from that, it is, I think, 30 minutes for, I think it's 35 minutes for verbal and 40 minutes for quant. And there are 20 questions in each section, but you can go back to the questions. And that is something which is different from MBA, from GMAT. Which means that you can switch within the section, you can go back to any question depending on your time, right? And the questions are vocab heavy, they have critical reasoning, they have a number of reading comprehensions, and the math part is extremely easy. The quant part is pretty easy in the first section, and the data analytics, they might take more time if your level is hard, but it is apparently 10th to 12th grade math, so that part is not very hard. And the scoring is like, so there is, it is on a scaled score again, depending on how hard it is, how many people gave it. So the writing section is scored out of 6 in total. The verbal section is out of 170 again, scaled score. And the mathematics is out of 130 again. So the total is 340.
Okay, so both the exams are adaptive in nature.
Yeah.
So we had one doubt, what is the eligibility criteria for giving both the exams, and is there any limitation on how many times we can attempt the exam, anything like that?
So in GRE you can give 5 times a year, and you cannot give 2 exams within 21 days of each other. So if you take the first exam like one day, the next exam you can take only 21 days and 5 times a year, but apart from that I think there are no limitations.
Okay.
More or less the same for GMAT as well. So you can give it 5 times in a year. I'm not sure what is the frequency between minimum allowed time between 2 exams. I think it's less than 21 days. I think it's about 7 days or something. You can't give twice in the same week. So that is for GMAT.
And what is the eligibility criteria? Anything to be specific?
There is no eligibility criteria. I think anybody can give it. It's just very expensive, so it's $200 per exam. So that's why people don't give it unless they really want to apply. So that's it.
Okay. And the scores are all valid for 5 years. So you can give it anytime, but you have to make sure that you submit them before within 5 years.
Okay. So what is the right time to start the preparations for these exams?
Like Tiasha, I procrastinated a lot too. So what happens is the deferred MBA applications start by mid-March, so 15th of March around. So I was very lazy after placements and everything, and I was having the time of my life. So I did not really bother to prepare, and I started again like Tiasha in I think the first week of February or something. So I had like 1 month, 4 weeks or 5 weeks for preparation of GMAT. When I say 4 weeks or 5 weeks, I started where I was like, what is GMAT? So from there to attempting GMAT, I had like 5 weeks. So I gave my GMAT on 1st March, and I kept 10 to 15 days for preparing the first application, which was due 15th March. So this is not the ideal way to do it. Don't do it this way at all. Please start preparation at least 2 months before your scheduled GMAT exam. So the best GMAT or GRE, I would say. So the best thing about these exams is you can book your exam today and write it tomorrow. So it's not like you have to pay months and months in advance, and the date is fixed and everything. So there is no harm of starting early, that is why. So when you feel like you have reached your peak of preparation, which could be 1 month or even 20 days if you're too good, then you can just pay and attempt it then and get it done with. You don't have to wait. You don't have to time your preparation in such a way that you give your exam exactly on the day you had planned. So that is the one advantage. So start at least 2 months in advance. In GRE and GMAT, the verbal sections are very challenging. the grammar, I had to go back to parallelism, modifiers, idioms, and everything that I had studied, I don't know, in eighth grade and start from the scratch because I did not remember anything. And it's very grammar intensive sometimes. And in GRE, it's very vocabulary intense. So it takes time to prepare. So give yourself that time. So the 1 month that I prepared, I had to spend almost seven hours a day to, you know, get somewhere. So I would say, like, spread yours evenly, make sure you start early. But would love to hear from Tyasha.
Yeah, so I think, like Vasanta said, even I do not recommend what I did. So essentially, I remember I booked my GRE date on 3rd March and I gave it on 16th March, which was the last possible day for giving it. So I could not submit my scores to Wharton on the deadline, and I had to mail them that my scores I'll get late. So I'll send it to you, and I had to send it to them by mail. And because of some constraints, I could not book it before because I had not really prepared for it before that. So I think it took me, I prepared properly for about 10-12 days in March and about 10-12 days in February properly. And I think I'd recommend that people should start early January or even give off their GRE as soon as their placements are done. Like, if when they have time, they should just get done with their GRE or GMAT, whatever, and get it out of the way so that they can focus on other things. Apart from that, what is the right time? So I think right time is very dependent on the person. So for me, I thought that was the right time, specifically because when I gave my mocks, in my first mock, I was getting about a 331. One of those ETS mocks, I was getting about a 331. And I wanted to score above a 335. So I calibrated about how much I was getting in my mocks. And according to that, I booked my date. And I think in my final mocks, I was getting about a 336, 337. And the final score came around that only, about 338. So I think the right time is very personal dependent. And I think one way to do it would be to calibrate how your mocks are going and when you're getting around your target score range to try and book the date.
Exactly. So even for GMAT, right? So it said that your actual score on your date of exam will be plus minus 20 of your average score that you have gotten in your mocks. So it depends on where your mocks are at and what is your target score. Based on that, you should time your preparation.
Okay. So the next question. So what is the preparation strategy and what are the resources that you used for while preparing for the GMAT or GRE exam? Or you can refer to any coaching institutes or something like that.
So I'll start with GMAT for myself. So I did not use anything other than the official.
I think the video is paused.
Yeah, Vasanta, you are not audible too. There might be some network issue. Tyasha, would you like to start on that?
So for GRE, I think the major resources which I used were the official guides. And I think the official guides, both the verbal and font, as well as for the question papers, I think official guides were my like Bible for the entire GRE exam. Apart from that, I practiced vocabulary, especially from the Barron's word lists. And there was this app, Magoosh Vocab Builder, which I extensively used. So these were my major resources. Apart from that, whichever sections, for example, reading comprehensions, I practiced from one or two Magoosh's ebooks, but I mainly referred to the official guides for this and no other coaching institute.
Am I audible now?
Yeah, Vasanta.
Yeah, great. So, like the Asha, I did not pay for or did not take any other coaching institutes. I used the official guides as well, mostly, and a lot of other free resources that were available. So, there is something called the official guides, which you can buy off of Amazon. It's a set of three books, one for quant, one for verbal, and one for all the sections together, which are the four sections. So, these books are really good, and along with the books you get an online access where you can attempt all the questions that are present in the book online in the way that you know you would attempt on your computer test in GMAT. Actually, you can select the number of questions you want to attempt at once, you can select the difficulty level, which section you want from, and then you can create banks of questions for that for yourself, and you can attempt it online. So that was really good. So the one thing, like I said, right, for GMAT, the problem is how many ever questions you solve, your actual set of questions might be very difficult because your target might be higher. So if you're targeting between 700 to 800, then your questions will be very difficult as compared to the average score level questions that you would have solved throughout your preparation. So for that, there is one amazing resource called the 700 to 800 questions in GMAT Club. So whoever's trying to attempt GMAT, do go over the GMAT Club website and register and start looking through the content. So there is tons of content available for GMAT aspirants on GMAT Club, one of which is the 700 to 800 Club. So what they have done is they have put together a set of 200 to 300 questions for every topic of every section, which are the most difficult questions that have come in GMAT in the past few years. So those are the, if you are able to solve those questions well, then you have prepared yourself for the 700 to 800 score range. So these question banks are available for free on GMAT Club. You can download it from there. And there are solutions as well. So that's great too. So between this GMAT Club and the official guide questions, I had more questions than I could solve for, you know, preparation itself. So that is great. So now in terms of the theory, right? So especially for verbal, it's very important to go back to the basics and study. So for that, I had the help of Manhattan. So there are three books for Manhattan Verbal, which are really good in terms of covering the basics in a very quick and understandable manner. They have practice tests too. So there are three books for GMAT Verbal, which is one is for critical reasoning, one is for sentence correction, and one is for reading comprehension. All these three books are free. You can download it off of the internet again. And so yeah, those three books helped me a lot with verbal, and especially so during the preparation, I used to keep track of my mistakes a lot. So I used to keep checking exactly in which section and which topic was I making the most amount of mistakes. Was I, you know, weak at modifiers, or was it parallelism, or was it idioms or nouns or pronouns or whatever. So whenever I felt that there's this one topic that I'm really bad at, I used to go on YouTube, and there are a few channels, which is, there's Veritas Prep, there is GMAT Ninja, and there are a couple other channels which make really good content on topic wise, you know, on every topic. So I used to go over those topics that I'm feeling, you know, a week at, they are free again, so you don't have to pay. And I used to go over that content, and it was really, really good in terms of tackling my areas of weaknesses. So between official guides, the Manhattan books, the GMAT 700 to 800 Club, and the multitude of options available on YouTube, which is free, I was able to manage my preparation. I did not need any other resources. And especially for mock tests, there are almost every website provides at least two or three mock tests for free. So I used to attempt those free mock tests again. I did not pay for anything. But the problem, like I said right before, it's that nobody knows the algorithm in which GMAT is officially scored. So there is MBA.com, which is the official website through which you will pay for your exam. All the official resources are available too. So on that, there are official practice tests or mock tests, which are created by the people who actually set your GMAT exam. The algorithm is accurate. So there are six practice tests available, two of which are free and the other four are paid. So you'll have to pay about $60-$70 for all the four other practice tests which are paid. So I paid for those because I wanted to know exactly where my score is, because the other mock tests are not accurate. So the only resources that I paid were the official guides and the official mock tests that are available on MBA.com.
Okay, Vasanta, thank you. We had a small request that after this session, if you could share these resources or the name of the books that you have referred to, so that we can post it in the channel itself and everyone can just go through that.
Sure.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
So moving on to the next question. So it is about how did the preparation go along with the preparation of placements, like both the for exams and placements, how did it got managed?
So for me, the preparations did not really coincide with each other. So after placements, I had a lot of time. So in my autumn semester, I think my seventh semester, I had my placements. And after that, since I had taken up a lot of credits in that semester, I did not really have time to do anything else. And in my eighth semester is when I started the GRE preparation or even like the applications, and I started them around February, March. So I think these two did not really coincide at all for me.
It's the same case for me too. So they didn't coincide. I in fact decided to apply and prepare only after my ninth sem was over. When I was in the 10th semester, I decided in January. So it doesn't really coincide, and I don't think it would for anybody unless, you know, they want to apply for MSc or something, because those applications take time. But for GMAT, deferred MBA applications, I don't think it's important to start that early. You can start in January, and I think you'll be in a good place.
Okay, so what do you think is the best strategy to attempt the exam? So what was your strategy to attempt the exam? I know Vasanta told us that the pattern is not actually defined, but yeah, any strategy or something?
So just plan your prep, yeah. Go ahead, Yasha.
No, I was just thinking that this, attempting the strategy, this is very, but varied from person to person, depending on what their strength is. So I think for GRE specifically, there is no specific strategy where you can do for attempting the sections, since you have to attempt sections in the way they come and you don't really have an option to choose. So for example, if your verbal section is first, you have to attempt that first. Apart from that, I think in terms of like individual section-wise strategy, so for my writing sections, what I did was, I essentially took, so there are 30 minutes in which you have to read the prompt and answer the prompt. So for the first 2-3 minutes, I took some time to just understand what the prompt is about and then frame my answer accordingly as to how many paragraphs I will say, or like what stance am I going to say? Am I going to agree with it? Am I going to disagree with it? If yes, why? Or what are the problems, right? So for example, in the analyze the issue, you have to analyze whether or not you agree with it or whether or not there are certain problems with what they have said, right? And similarly, for analyze the argument, you have to poke holes in their argument, talk about what are the problems there, what other questions need to be answered, and all of these come with a little bit of practice. And the questions are very similar to what you have already prepared before through the official guides. So they don't take you by surprise, but you still have to frame an answer. So for the first 2-3 minutes, I would frame an answer. Then I would spend time just writing it down, and typing the whole thing takes a lot of time. And then I would keep about 5 to 7 minutes at the end to just revise my answer, see if there are any glaring mistakes or if there's any other way I can reframe that. And for the writing sections, that is how I attempted it. For the vocabulary, so what I did was simple, right? So the shorter questions I attempted first, and the longer reading comprehension questions, which were about 3 questions per paragraph, those I attempted last. My vocabulary was, so I had prepared extensively for my vocabulary, and that is the major part which I focused on even during my GRE prep for the 10-12 days, right? And the vocab questions were thus, like, they took very little time, and I did those first. And then after that, the reading comprehension, which were a little bit more complicated and indirect, those I spent more time on. But again, I think this is very dependent on what is more comfortable for the person. So if somebody is stronger at reading comprehension than at vocabulary, then they should probably attempt it according to what maximizes their utility. And the last 5 minutes I saved in every section for just revising or like going back to the marked answers to see where all I can do. And for the quantitative sections, again, I attempted like the shorter questions first, and the data interpretation questions, which essentially took more time, I attempted those at last. And then I kept 5-7 minutes at the end to just go through every question and like go through the review points.
So in GMAT, you can't really have a strategy because you have to attempt the questions in the order they come. The only where you get a choice is where you choose which section you want to attempt first. But again, it's not like JE, right? So if you finished math in less than 90 minutes, then you get more time for physics and chemistry. It doesn't work that way. So once you finish a section, then the clock resets and you have the exact amount of time again for the next section. So I attempted the sections in which I had most confidence in. So I was most confident about quantitative. So I attempted that first. And I then attempted verbal because these two are the most important sections in GMAT. So out of which you get your 800 score. So I attempted quant first and then verbal. And then I attempted integrated reasoning and AWA in that order. So integrated reasoning, because it's very easy. So it's just data interpretation, how well you understand graphs that are presented. And it's very, it's just pretty simple. So you can attempt that. And last I did was AWA, because by then I would have finished all the, you know, multiple answer type questions, and I would have 30 minutes to myself to clear my head and then think and then attempt. So you also get 2 8-minute breaks in GMAT. You can take it whenever you want, after which section you want. So you just have to tell the instructor before itself. So there are multiple ways of doing that as well. So that I would say is about the exam. And again, you can't, you have to attempt the questions in that order. So make sure that you're keeping track of time, and make sure that when you're attempting, you're, just a second, yeah. When you're attempting, your time is not running out and you're not spending too much time on the current question, because you can't skip questions here. So it's okay to just, you know, mark the wrong answer or whatever answer that comes to your mind and move on if you're spending too much time on one question. And analytical writing assessment is a lot like what Tiasha described regarding analyze the argument. So you can use the same tactics. You have to first read the argument and then spend a couple minutes in understanding the loopholes in what is presented and what are the other questions that need to be added, answered, and then spend the next 15 to 20 minutes in actually typing it out. So yeah, that is basically the strategy during the exam time. And make sure that, again, like I said before, you attempt the GMAT exam during the peak of your preparation, when your mock scores are at their highest. So that's the only thing I would say.
It is like one last thing. So the problem with these both of these exams are they're extremely long. So in GRE exam, before you get a break, you have 1 hour of writing, then you have 30 minutes of verbal, 35 minutes of verbal and 40 minutes of quant. And after that, you get a break. And then you again have 3 sections. And you get a break of about 10 minutes and 1 minute between sections. So I would suggest use your 10 minutes break effectively, like have water, have some food, and just refocus on how to attempt, because it is because the second sections are even harder. So they take a lot of mental space. So I think that is one way you need to prepare your breaks accordingly. And when you give your mock tests, to always give them in that like whole stretch at a time, and not to, you know, give these particular sections differently, since that also affects how your final performance works out at the end.
Absolutely.
Okay, so now...
Just one more thing. So in GMAT, right, you have 2 ways of attempting it. You can give GMAT at home or you can give it in the center, and both are equally valid. That's what they say, but nobody knows whether that's true. So you can actually attempt it at home without any supervision also. That is possible in GMAT. I would say like choose based on your comfort. For me, I gave it in the exam center because at home I don't feel as serious as I would in a center. So I usually like the setting of an exam center where everything is quiet and I'm in the most focused zone. But if you are a person who's more comfortable at home and you attempt best when you're comfortable, then you can choose GMAT at home as well. That option is there.
Actually, I had the choice, but in Ranchi we did not really have any center, so I chose to give it at home. I think one thing which also really works out for the at home thing is the timing. So I am more of a night person, and I gave my exam at 7 p.m. in the night. And I think 7 to 11, that is the time where I worked best, and that is the time I chose for the exam. So that flexibility is also there at the at home portion, which is true.
Okay, so that's flexible kind of exam. So now we will have the common frequently asked questions in that we had from our registration links. So here it is. Yes, so yeah, when did you start applying for the foreign? Yeah, Charvi, continue.
Yeah, just that only, that when to start applying for the foreign universities. What is the right time?
So I think there's no right time, right? So these universities, they release their deadlines very early, and depending on how much time you need or how you've taken your exam, whether you're ready with your other materials, since these applications are extremely long, right? They're 12 pages long applications, and each of these, and some of them have like extremely long essays, and they take time to write, they take time to frame. Then apart from that, you have to decide your goals, you have to decide your scores, see what is happening, right? So I think there is no specific right time, and it depends completely on the person how much time they will take. But I think one thing is to essentially choose your priority order and start asking for like letters of recommendation early on. So at least like 1 month before the deadline, contact your recommenders, talk to them about what you want to do, contact, like take your exam, see how you're going to frame it, and then start applying according to which universities you finally want to end up applying.
So the recommendations for MBA applications are also very different now that Tyasha brought it up at the right time. So you can't take recommendations from your professors and get it done with. So every college has a different recommendation question, and they expect the answer to be custom to that particular school as well, even the recommendation, not just the essay. And the recommendations are expected to be given from someone who knows you in a work environment and who can vouch for your leadership and management skills. So that usually is not professors for us, unless we have worked with them for some society or a cell or something. So you'll have to get it from your intern guides or something. So it takes a lot of time to prepare them as well. You need committed recommenders, because again, if you're applying for 5 colleges, then they have to write 10 recommendations at least. And each of that recommendation will be different. So they'll have to spend that much time on your recommendation, and each of them will be about 300 to 400 words. So that again, so just think about it from the recommender side as well. You need to give them sufficient amount of time, and they need to be committed towards your application as well. So finding the right recommenders and preparing them to answer your recommendation questions in the best way possible is very important. And again, you cannot see your own recommendation, you cannot see what your recommender has written for you. So it's very important to prepare them beforehand. Otherwise, it's very possible that they write something that is not relevant to that school, or that is not relevant to the question that is being asked, and you lose out on your chances for a good admission. And again, the essays as well. So you will have to write 2, or minimum 2 for most of the schools, and for some 1. Essays are again very lengthy, very long. The topics is again different for every school, and they expect you to custom your essay. The story is also a lot of times very different for each school. In some school, you'll say that, you know, you want to become an entrepreneur. In some schools, you might say that, you know, I want to do an MBA so that I can progress in my career better. So it depends on what the school is looking for. So you have to tailor your essay as well based on what the school looks for. So it's quite challenging in that sense. So do not think that you can start your application today and submit it tomorrow and be done with it. It takes a lot of time. So the best thing is when you're starting for your GMAT or GRE prep itself, open the application portal and see what are the things that they've asked, and create a document of all the recommendation questions that your target schools are asking, and start contacting your recommenders at the same time. So let these 2 processes run side by side, your applications and your GMAT or GRE prep, so that you don't see something out of the blue that pops up on your screen a day or 2 before your application deadline.
Yeah, you need to have ample amount of time.
Correct. Absolutely.
So this was a doubt that are there a lot of colleges that allow 2-year deferred programs, or is it only what?
I think there are about 9-10 colleges, right? You have to check, but I think there are about 9-10.
Most of the M7s do. So Wharton, Stanford, HPS, MIT, Columbia, Kellogg, then there's Darden. All of these schools provide a deferred MBA program. So yeah, it's not that uncommon.
Okay.
Yeah, so Tyasha, would you like to add on that something?
The number of colleges? I know. So I think there are about 9-10 colleges. I think Haas is also one of the colleges which applies. I'm not sure. Haas, Columbia also. But yeah, I think those are the ones which offer deferred MBA. And it's not just 2 years. So it depends, right? It can be 2 to 4 years, 2 to 5 years. It depends.
Yeah.
So the 2 year thing is not specific to any college.
Okay. Yeah. So the next question is about, is there any weightage given to the prior work experiences we have?
I don't know what you mean by work experiences. If you are talking about internships, then yes, I think internships do matter a lot, especially in terms of framing your story or in terms of like during the interviews or essentially just knowing about what you want to do. I think internships do add a lot of value in your overall application. However, I think in terms of full-time work experience, so most of these, especially the deferred MBA programs, they do not allow full-time work experience. And if you have full-time work experience of about a year, you're not eligible for these programs and you'll have to apply to the direct work. So, yeah.
So you have to be a final year student if you're applying for a deferred program. So that is, if you're applying in 2021, then you need to have graduated or you are going to graduate between October 2020 and September 2021. So that is the timeline in which you can apply. So that's the eligibility criteria. And the deferred applicants are treated and their applications are evaluated separately. So their questions are also tailored to people they know are full-time students. So they don't expect work experience. They only expect some voluntary work, NGO work, internships, and maybe research projects. So that is all they ask for.
Okay. So yeah, this is a really legit question. So if you find yourself lacking somewhere in English language or vocabulary, so how did you improve your language skills?
So if you're not already really good or well-versed with these, then start your preparation early and take a mock test. So one of the you can take a free mock test maybe a year before even now and see exactly what are the skills that you're lacking at, even though you don't have to start the full-time preparation right away. So if you feel that you're bad at or you're not that great at verbal or vocabulary or grammar, then you can start. Everything works from practice only. It just takes different amounts of time for different people to get to the same place, but you'll eventually get there. So start early in that case. You can definitely improve your vocabulary, grammar by reading. So start reading online. At the same time, you can read novels, you can read documents regarding anything. So whatever you're interested in, start reading, make it a regular practice. And you can start attempting you can start reading from the Manhattan books as well. You can start reading from GRE material. You can start listening to podcasts as well. So I found this very late. So on Spotify, there are a few podcasts for grammar and vocabulary, especially targeted towards GMAT and GRE applicants. So you can, as a daily habit, you can listen to one podcast a day and learn whatever you can in the process. Try to communicate better. Try to communicate in English with your friends on a regular basis. And it's just about building a habit. That's it.
So I actually agree with Vasanta. I think for me, English, the way I prepared essentially specifically for GRE was essentially through both the Barron word list, where I looked at the words and understood what the sentences they are used in or what are the different variations of the word. And the word list helped me. But I think what regular practice in this particular vocab part helped me was this Magoosh app. So this vocab builder app, it is built more like a game. So you can choose what are the correct options. And this app, I completed this app around 3-4 times because I just did 5-10 minutes a day whenever I was bored. And since it was on my phone and I'm always on my phone, so it did not really take a lot of time. But I think that is one thing which helped me improve my vocabulary, especially for the words, a lot. Right? For the reading comprehension, I think, I have a reading habit in general, and reading is something I'm fond of. And I think that really helped me because of comprehension parts, the comprehension passages, they involve a lot of understanding. And I think that is something which you need to start very early from if you're not comfortable or if you're not very fluent in reading or understanding these comprehensions. So maybe start 4-5 months, start reading books, newspaper articles, editorials, etc., whatever you find interesting, and just develop a habit so that during the exam, you do not take a lot of time. That is essentially what I did for the English part.
Okay. So far we have quite means we have learned so much about the GRE exam and GMAT exam. So if you are means if you still can mention some of the differences or similarities between the exam.
I think similarities are that they have vocabulary, they have like English heavy, and then mathematics is similar. So I think the syllabus is similar. The pattern itself is very different, and the focus they have is very different. So like I said before, GVAT focuses much more on grammar and critical reasoning, whereas GRE, it is more vocab heavy in general, the verbal sections. I think mathematics section is pretty similar from what I have read. The mathematics section is similar. Apart from that, GRE has two writing sections, and these writing sections, you need some preparation because even those scores do matter a little bit. And you need to score at least around a 5.5, 6 in general for a GRE score, for a GRE writing score. So I think that is one thing.
Correct. And like Tiasha said, so if you're a person who can analyze, who's better at analysis and, you know, linking two different things together and everything, then GMAT is better. And if you're a person who has a good vocabulary, who has had a reading habit in the past, and who's already well-versed with English words and everything, then GRE is better, I would say. So in GMAT, they don't expect you to know the meaning of any complicated words. They don't expect you to know the usage of these words and sentences and everything. So it's all about... it's critical reasoning. The only place where you would really need to use your English and grammar is, I would say, sentence correction. So they give you a sentence and they underline a part of that sentence. And if that, and they give you 4 or 5 options in which you can write the same underlined part in a different way. And you have to choose the option that is the most accurate in terms of following grammatical rules. So that's the only part in GMAT which tests your grammar, I would say. So yeah, again, if you go over the rules, if you practice the rules, then you would be in a good place. But that is majorly the difference between GRE and GMAT.
Yeah, so would you like to give a final advice to all the KGPNs about the preparation and all for GRE and GMAT?
So don't fret about it this early. Like if you're in your final year now, then just give a mock test maybe a year in advance just to see whether, you know, your scores are good or not. So I think somebody asked in the chat as well. So anything above 720 or something is a good GMAT score. I had a 750, which is 98th percentile, and that's sufficient. So everything else depends upon your... the way you put together your application itself, whether your essays are coherent, whether the story is, engaging, and whether it is something that they're looking for in their candidate. So that is what carries the most amount of weightage once your score is above a certain threshold. So, I would say, like, get your GMAT, GRE out of the way and start working on your applications. I learned this the hard way because I had, like I said, only 10 days before my first application, although I did get my recommendations out of the way earlier, but it took a lot of time to put together the essays. So I would say the same thing. Get your GMAT and GRE out of the way because the score is valid for 5 years. Then start working on your applications, making a coherent story, and getting your essay reviewed by as many seniors as possible and your friends as well. It's very important for the essay to sound like you. You cannot just put it on a paraphrasing tool and make it sound complicated and think that you're done with it. It's very important that it sounds like an actual person speaking. So there are a lot of factors about the essay and the recommendations that are very, very important, which can be sidelined if you focus too much on your score itself. So if you're applying for a deferred MBA program, then keep that in mind.
I think I agree with Vasanthi. I think it's very important. I think the first step will be for you to decide which exam you want to take. And I think a little bit of preparation alongside the mock test, as well as just asking other people and seeing what you're comfortable with. Deciding that early on around December, January is very important. And then just getting the exam out of the way and not procrastinating till the last minute like I did, since that sometimes might work out worse for you. So for example, if in your first attempt you did not do as well, you need to have like sufficient buffer time time for a second attempt as well. And I think that is something you should give yourself time for. So I think you should give your GRE or GMAT, whichever exam, early on around January, and then start the applications and like deciding the entire applications. I think another thing which really helped me with the essays was essentially one of my close friends. She reviewed my essay about 4 or 5 times and just to ensure that it sounded like me, it sounded original and it sounded like methodical, right? And I don't think it was very complicated. It was not hi-fi. It was a very more, it sounded like a casual conversation that I was talking about myself. So I think that is one thing which is important, like Vasanta said, for the essays themselves. But again, you need to start your essays at least 10, 15 days early to have an idea, because your essays keep on changing. I mean, my first draft and my last draft looked extremely different from each other, and they did not look like they had been written by the same person. They looked very different. And I think giving yourself time for those revisions and not submitting like a first draft is very important. Apart from that, I also think it's very important to keep the endurance throughout, right? So this application process is very complicated. It's very hard and it's exhausting. So by the time April was done, I think I was completely drained and I did not want to do anything else after that point, and having to manage that alongside like the credits. So just make sure your final semester, you have easier subjects. If you're planning on doing these applications, just take easier subjects which take up less time or which are essentially not very intensive in nature, so that you have the brain space to do both simultaneously. And I think another thing would be to keep up the motivation in your final semester, since by that time you have your placements already done and you do not really have a lot to do. You know that you have a job guarantee and you just kind of procrastinate thinking, you know what, I have a lot of time, and then you don't. So that it's just important to keep that mentality in mind and like take the advice of your friends and take criticism very positively instead of negatively. Just take the criticism and move forward.
Okay, so yeah, now we can have questions from the chat box. I hope it's visible to you all, the chat box.
Sure. Will you guys be selecting the questions?
I think you can answer.
Answer if the questions are not answered before, like.
Yeah.
If there's something new, then you can. Answer.
If you feel you can add something, so.
Okay, so what I could see, like the latest from Ritik, what kind of impact do CG and other engineering courses have on B-School applications? CG is very important, guys, everywhere. So CG is important. So make sure that your CG is high, not just for placements. Anybody who says that CG is not important is lying. So it's very important even during B-School applications. They want people who would get there and actually study their courses. They wouldn't want people who would just go there and do time pass. So they do give a lot of importance for CGPA. I can't stress this enough. It is very important.
I think CGPA, extracurriculars, the positions of responsibility you have, I think every part of your resume is very important. The kind of awards you have received, the kind of internships you have done. I mean, in our application, I think they had us include everything. Like right from the awards you have received to like what is your current CGPA, what is your ranking. I mean, they ask a lot of this stuff. So I think whoever says that, it's like Vasanta said, whoever says that CGPA above like a certain range does not matter, is like, I mean, that's just not true for these things. I think I just saw one question that they asked about TOEFL. So since we studied in IIT Kharagpur, where the language of instruction is English, we did not need to take the TOEFL. For any of these, at least for the MBA applications, we did not need to take a TOEFL. For MS applications, I'm not sure whether or not it's important. But these schools do not need it. I mean, you have the option of giving it, but you can choose not to. I did not give it.
So when you say how much CG is sufficient, it's like placements itself again. So you can't say that, you know, you have a 9-pointer and everything is sorted, or you can't say that you have a 7-pointer and nothing will work out for you. Either extremes is not true. So it's a very good mix of everything that you've done in your life, like Priyasha said. It's about your campus, they'll even ask you about what job offer you're taking up as soon as this, your academic year ends. So that is important, which field you're entering, your essay, your story, your recommendations, your positions of responsibility, your past internships, your academic awards, and your CGPA. They are all a part of it. So if you have a lower CGPA, then you'll have to make up for it through the other parts of your application. But you can't, there's nothing like, if you have a low CGPA, then you can't get in at all. It doesn't work that way. I had a friend from IIT Delhi who applied the cycle. He's a 7-pointer or 7.5 or something, and he did get into the interview round of Wharton. So he had his own startup, which was up and running. So that was kind of his spike on his CV. So if you have something that can make up for low CGPA, then that will definitely help you balance it out.
I think one, in most of these applications, they have an optional essay section that if you think that you have any weakness in your application, you can choose to address it. So for example, if your CGPA in one particular semester or maybe two semesters is bad, and if there's a specific reason for that being a low, you can essentially choose to explain it. Contrarily, you can also choose to like make up for the scores with your GRE or GMAT scores, since I think that also balances it out. But like Vasantha said, the holistic view is more important than any individual part specifically, but they are all important. One question I saw, what's considered a decent GRE score range for getting into these B schools? So I'm not sure what the decent score is. I think targeting above a 330 is a safe bet. And because in above 330, most of this, since a lot of these schools, so since GMAT is mostly used for MBAs, they use the EPS GRE to GMAT conversions tool a lot of times to compare equally. Not all schools do this, but some schools do this. So I think you can check with regards to that. But I think above a 330, depending, and scoring more in the quant section than the verbal section is important for these exams a little bit, for the conversion part especially.
There's another question about what's the difference between deferred MBA and usual MBA. So if you apply for a usual MBA, if you apply in the 2021 cycle, then you're expected to join in September 2021 or something, fall of 2021. So that is the usual MBA. But in a deferred MBA, they'll reserve a seat for you if you go through the process and if you succeed in qualifying through the end, all of the rounds. And you can choose when you want to join, depending upon how much work experience and how many years you're comfortable with before your MBA itself. So since I and Tiasha have qualified for the Wharton deferred admission program this year in 2021, we can join anytime between 2023 and 2025. We just have to tell the school 6 months in advance that we want to join in the upcoming semester, reserve a seat for us. That's what we're supposed to do. But other than that, there is no commitment prior to joining itself about when we want to join or what time we'll matriculate. It depends completely on our comfort. So the deferred MBA gives you that kind of flexibility in deciding on your future plans. Okay, so there's another question, I think. Yeah, you were saying something?
No, continue.
Yeah, about why.
We have covered.
Yeah, there's another question about why a foreign MBA makes a lot of sense if one plans to have a long-term career in India afterwards. So one reason why people prefer MBA abroad over MBA in India is for networking and for international exposure. So the B schools abroad have people coming in from a diverse set of work experiences, from a diverse age group, from people from different sectors of life, different countries and different backgrounds. So that kind of adds a lot to your perspective once you finish your MBA. So when I was interviewing with Wharton, the person who took my interview was an army veteran from the US. So he worked in the army for 5 years, and then he is doing an MBA and he would go back to the army. So you'll find these kind of people when you go to your MBA abroad, and you'll be in amongst the best minds from all across the world. So that is the experience why people go for an MBA abroad. And again, if you are planning to do an MBA abroad, then you have to keep in mind that you will have to spend a couple of years or 3 or 4 years abroad to clear those loans, because it's very expensive unless you're highly loaded, which if you are, then you're very lucky. So So yeah, so you have to plan your next 4 or 5 years after your MBA itself, and you have to think about that as well before you apply. So those are probably the things that you need to keep in mind.
I think one disadvantage of deferred MBA programs, since we've talked a lot about the advantages, a disadvantage is that you don't get scholarship decisions right now. So in a sense, like right now, we matriculate later or maybe 2-3 years later, and you get your scholarship decisions the year you decide to matriculate. And I think that is important because that also depends on how much loan you have to take or what other avenues you have to select or what scholarships you need to apply for. So I think that is one thing which I do not think I have figured out yet. And I think I'll figure it out in the next 2-3 years about what I have to do. But yeah, that is one thing which we will need to keep into mind, whoever applies for like that one MBA.
Okay, there's another question about if you apply for a deferred MBA at XYZ B school with your current score, and then next year whether you can apply to the same school again with a work experience. So yes, you can. So you can apply again if you do not qualify in the deferred MBA and with the same score, it is completely acceptable. You can just add your work experience and apply again. The school specifically say that they will not hold your current application valid for your next application. They would not go over your past applications if you're applying again. So that is there.
But also, I think one difference is that when you are applying for a non-deferred MBA, the average class experience is about 4 or 5 years. So people who have 4 or 5 years of work experience, you will be evaluated alongside them if you're applying for a non-deferred. So it's a better idea, since these applications are also expensive in nature when you're applying for a non-deferred MBA. So for the deferred MBA, I think every application costs about $100. And the non-deferred MBA, they cost about $250. I think $250 to $300 per application. So you also need to make sure that you are competing on a similar level, which is why maybe I think from what I read, 3-4 years of experience is necessary or like recommended before you apply, even though that's not an eligibility criteria as such.
Yeah, that's a very good point. So deferred MBA is way cheaper than applying for a full-time MBA. Some of the applications are actually free. For example, I think Columbia, MIT, all of these, MIT Sloan School of Management, all of these are free of cost. So, but if you're applying for a full-time MBA, then you'll have to pay $200 to $50 per every application. There's another question about, are the applications evaluated on a rolling basis? So again, it's different. Columbia evaluates on a rolling basis, but the other schools, Wharton, Stanford, Harvard, all of them do not start looking at applications until the deadline has passed. So it depends. It's a school to school basis.
Okay. So I saw a question about the MIM programs. So I'm not very sure about MIM programs, but from what I know is that people with 0 to 2 years experience, they can apply directly to these MIM programs after graduation. And I think the format itself is different for those applications. So I'm not sure about that, but that is what I do know, that the work experience requirement is different. In terms of that, I think there's one program, I think the Yale Silver Scholars program, which you can also apply with a 0 to 2 years. So you can join immediately after your graduation if you are selected for that. And it is a 3-year program with 1-year internship, from what I know. So that is similar, where you do not really need work experience, the Yale Silver Scholars. This one I know for the US, but apart from that, MIM, I don't really know a lot.
So there's a question about the interview rounds, scholarship programs. So scholarship programs are not applied for right away for deferred MBA. You'll have to apply during the year of your matriculation, which will be 2 to 5 years, 2 to 4 years from now. And about the interviews, again, every school has a different interview process, not just in what questions are asked, but also about who takes your interview. So in Wharton, actually, second year students who are current Wharton, who are currently studying in Wharton took our interview. In Stanford, I think an alumnus takes your interview. In Harvard and everything, the interviews are taken by admission committee. So every school has its own set of interview process, which differs widely from one another. In Wharton, you have something like a group discussion before your actual interview, which is very unique as compared to the other interview processes. So it's very school to school dependent. think we've covered. Is there anything left?
Can't really find anything.
Yeah, just one question, if it might have been left, that if a person is not aiming for consulting or management profile for placements as of now, but is looking to do a deferred MBA, how common and recommended is this?
So I think it's fairly common. I think there are a lot of different fields which they take from. So some people who have their own startups apply. Some people who have like a finance background, who have a consulting background, who have like a tech background, who have an engineering background. I think it's very diverse. And depending on the school, they have like certain percentages which have a trend. So I think Harvard takes more from a tech background. In general, from what I have seen in the statistics, Wharton has a more consultant and finance background based. But again, it's very variable. And even if you're not applying for a consulting, I think it's very common to apply for a deferred MBA.
Right. MIT looks for innovation. So if you have a good startup idea that you still did not implement, but you want to, then you can base that as your essay application. And you can. So it's just about how well you validate your candidature through your essays and recommendations. That's all that matters. We do have people who got into Wharton this year from India who had gotten their placements from Goldman Sachs. There were two, I think, one from our campus and one from, I don't know which, but there are two.
I think it was, Bombay.
Bombay, right? Shreya. So there are, so Goldman Sachs, so it doesn't depend upon management or consulting, whatever field you are entering. If you can properly tell them why you want an MBA, and if you can justify that through your essay, then it's totally acceptable and they will definitely consider that. So or you need to remember that even MBA schools are looking for diversity. They want a good mix of consulting, management, tech, doctors, RV professionals, whatever different things that you can see. So you should take that as an advantage, because not a lot of tech people do apply for MBA. So you have, if you are interested in MBA and if you have a good reason to pursue that, then you should definitely do that.
So I think it's we have covered everything.
So I think one question I saw, that can you please suggest high frequency words for both GRE and GMAT? I'm assuming these high frequency words are from the vocabulary section, and I would suggest like the balanced list of like, I think, 1,100 words. That contains most of the high frequency words, the GRE at least.
And GMAT doesn't look for anything as such. There's nothing like a high frequency word that you need to remember, so it's fine.
Okay, so thank you, Vasanta. Thank you, Tiasha, for your precious time. And thank you, audience. You have been very interactive throughout the session. So I hope this session was helpful for everyone.